Welcome to the Johns Hopkins Women's Health Podcast, A Woman's Journey, Insights That Matter. I'm Kelly Gear-Ripken, and I invite you to listen to Johns Hopkins specialists discuss the latest topics in women's health. Now here's your host, Lillie Shockney.
Hi, this is Professor Lillie Shockney from A Woman's Journey at Johns Hopkins, and this is our podcast, Healthy Insights That Matter. As baby boomers age, and I am a baby boomer, the World Health Organization has stated that by 2060, there will be 95 million people who will be 65 or older in age. To talk about aging well, I am joined today by geriatrician and researcher, Dr. Peter Abadir, an associate professor of medicine at the Johns Hopkins University School of Medicine. So welcome, Dr. Abadir, and thank you for joining us today to talk about two major health issues associated with aging. So we know that Alzheimer's disease is something that many people are worried about, and I am included in that worry group, and that there are 55 million people globally who have been diagnosed with Alzheimer's. Frailty also is a major concern with this rapidly growing age group. I understand that you have focused your research on dementia and frailty. So why did you select these two diagnoses?
Thank you, Dr. Shockney, for inviting me and for including me in this discussion. And I'm honored and excited to be with you and share some of our experiences. Indeed, both dementia and physical frailty are significant concerns as our population ages. And we chose to focus our research on these two areas because they represent major challenges to the health and independence of older adults. Dementia, particularly Alzheimer's disease, profoundly impacts cognitive function, while frailty affects the physical abilities of older adults. Together, they contribute to a decline in quality of life and increase the risk of adverse health outcomes, including falls, including mortality, including other bad things that happen to those older adults as they go through different stages of life and clinical exposure. So understanding and addressing these conditions can help improve the well-being of our older adults and potentially delay or prevent the onset of more severe health issues.
I'm so glad that you commented about quality of life, because I think that we underestimate the impact of losing independence has on older population. And today, with families not living together, I guess I would say, you know, we could go back, got to go back quite a ways, but I certainly do recall grandparents, parents, and children all under the same roof. That's over, unfortunately. The only time that it brought people back together was when we were dealing with the pandemic. But the ability for elderly people to rely on family members of a younger generation is incredibly difficult. Could you explain the difference between genomic DNA and mitochondrial DNA?
I want to touch first on something you mentioned, because social isolation is a big deal as we age, and the pandemic exposed the catastrophic impact of social isolation on older adults' physical and cognitive abilities. And it is definitely something that is important for us all to focus on and to work on ways to break that social isolation pandemic, if you will. Back to your question about genomic and mitochondrial DNA. The genomic DNA is a complete set of DNA found in the nucleus of cells, containing all the genetic blueprints that determines individual traits, inherited traits. So it's composed of chromosomes that carry thousands of genes. So this is what explains the traits that the person has. Mitochondrial DNA, on the other hand, is found in the mitochondria, which is the power plant of the cell. This is what produces energy. Mitochondrial DNA is really interesting because it's inherited only from the mother and contains all the genes crucial for functioning of mitochondria and energy production. So I like to joke with my kids and say that you get all your energy from your mom.
Power to the women, yes.
Yes.
at what point in time is it important to start looking at what our genetic and genomic makeup is to predict our future? Like, I have one set of grandparents who died in their mid-90s, but I have another set of grandparents that died much younger than that. Does that make any difference in predicting for future generations how long someone will be here or what their even state of frailty might be?
Thank you for asking that question. I think the answer is it depends, and that there are multiple factors that, in addition to the genetic makeup, can contribute to the lifespan of an individual. So exposures, including access to medications, including nutrition, exercise, habits, smoking, non-smoking, exposure to stressors, all of those are factors that you have to put them together in order to be able to make a full picture. And that's the challenging thing with studying humans. It's easier to study a mouse because you are controlling for the genetic makeup. You're controlling for the exposures. Humans are complicated. And that's why a lot of our research that we do in animal models do not make it to humans, because while mice, you give them that drug every day, humans may choose to take it every other day. The fact that grandparents lived longer definitely contributes. Genetic factors contribute, but it's not the only factor that can be determined. And some of the issues, the ethical dilemmas that those genetic studies go with, is that you're providing a likelihood of something, and that likelihood may happen or may not happen. So some of the ethical concerns, if you test somebody for likelihood of developing dementia, it's just a likelihood. But then that puts a lot of stress on that individual in the future and may impact their even insurance. Being able to be insured might be affected, although a lot of discussions on ethics of that is currently going.
That is a challenge. And though we would like to think that insurance companies wouldn't carve out based on certain diseases and disorders, we know that they do. That certainly can be an issue. I want to congratulate you. I understood that you have a recent publication about your research findings. Could you share some of the highlights of that 8-year study? That was a good longitudinal study. I'm sure that it has resulted in teaching a lot of new information.
Thank you so much for your kind remarks. And I just want to step back a little bit and explain how the mitochondrial and genomic DNA led to our work in what we call, and what everybody calls, the circulating cell-free DNA fragments. So while I'm not working in the genomic field or the mitochondrial DNA field, we're working on what's known as the liquid biopsy. Liquid biopsy is named so because you take the blood and you look for genetic materials, DNA material that's floating in that blood, that's called circulating cell-free DNA fragments. As we discussed, you have two sources of DNA in each cell. So you have the mitochondrial DNA coming from the mitochondria, and then the genomic DNA coming from the nucleus. And when the cell dies, you release the genomic DNA and the mitochondrial DNA to the circulation of the individual. There has been a lot of research on the circulating cell-free DNA that dates back to the early 40s, looking at the use of that DNA materials in two fields. First is the oncology field, because with sequencing the circulating cell-free DNA fragments, you can see signatures of certain cancers. So that's the first use, and there is a lot of movement towards using that liquid biopsy to identify cancers that might be hiding in the body. If you see the signature of a cancer on the genomic DNA fragments, then you know that there is a cancer hiding somewhere. So it's a complementary test to the annual checkup, mammography, colonoscopy, and other tests.
And it also hopefully would identify things even earlier than a screening.
And exactly right. And this is amazing about technology, that sequencing technology used to be extremely cost prohibitive, but with the advancement of technology, it's becoming much more sensitive and much cheaper to do so. That's something promising in the field of oncology. The other use for that was the maternal fetal medicine. As you know, when a woman gets pregnant, there are tests that we do to detect congenital anomalies, malformations, etc. Some of those tests are invasive because they have to go through and take a needle and collect a sample from the fetal area and detect some of the trisomy or the genetic malformations that the baby may have. An alternative approach to that is that you collect blood from the mother. If you see the genetic malformation in the DNA fragments, the circulating cell-free DNA fragments, it has to be coming from the fetus. So this is the other use for the liquid.
Wow, that's incredible.
We don't work in oncology. We don't work in maternal fetal medicine, but we work in using this liquid biopsy to identify changes in the overall loss of cells in the body. The more cells that die, the more nuclear material you are releasing into the circulation, and the more mitochondrial material that you are releasing into the circulation. So our 8-year study working with Rush Alzheimer's Disease Research Center focused on understanding the relationship between those circulating cell-free DNA fragments and aging-related conditions such as dementia and frailty. And one of the key highlights that we found that there are significant differences in the levels of the cell-free DNA fragments, the mitochondrial fragments, between healthy older adults and those with cognitive impairment or frailty.
What did your research show about the quantity changes with adults looking at genomic versus mitochondria? I'm chuckling to myself because I watched Forensic Files last night and they were talking about mitochondria on the show.
I'll tell you, Lillie, that mitochondria is a fascinating organelle because there are a lot of theories of how we got our mitochondria, not only because we got it from our mothers, but how did the first cell that has that bacteria in the evolutionary theory, mitochondria is a bacteria. And when you look at the basic research that's done at the mitochondria level, mitochondria acts like a bacteria in a lot of ways. They communicate to each other. They talk to each other. They even, in some infections that come from other bacteria, they cooperate to supply materials to the invading parasite, which is truly fascinating when you think about this foreign bacteria that somehow billions of years ago invaded a cell and became the cell that we know now.
I have the good fortune of being with you today and seeing the excitement on your face talking about all this. Obviously, our listeners are just hearing your voice, but I wanted them to know that you're in the right field. I can see that. It's written all over your face.
Thank you, Lillie. So I want to summarize the two studies to get back to your question about what did we find and how this work between two of the universities, Rush Alzheimer's Disease Research Center, which is a major Alzheimer's Disease Research Center, how did we work with them? So the Hopkins team worked with the Rush team to identify some of those changes. Since we started talking about mitochondria, I'll tell you first about the mitochondrial DNA fragments. So we looked at 672 community-dwelling older adults from the Chicago area. We quantified those circulating cell-free DNA fragments, and we looked at other markers that push people to age before their times, like chronic inflammation, like TNF-alpha receptor 1. Those are biomarkers of inflammation, as stress biomarkers that are associated with premature aging or frailty, like we call it. And we assessed cognitive and physical functions in older adults using the Rush different tests and scores. What we found in the mitochondrial fragments that floating in the serum, that one of the major findings is that the higher the levels of the circulating cell-free mitochondrial DNA fragments, the more inflammatory markers you have. And while this is totally speculation, we think that having a lot of those fragments floating in the serum, they are seen by the immune system, and the immune system triggers a response by increasing inflammation in an attempt to get rid of those fragments. But the problem is that the higher the inflammatory burden, the more you're pushing that person to age faster. This is speculation, but this is at least one of the findings, is that we were able to see a strong correlation between the mitochondrial DNA fragments levels in the serum and inflammatory markers. And that we show even though that at the time of visit, we were not able to show the higher the levels of mitochondrial DNA fragments were associated with cognitive and physical outcomes. However, longitudinally, the more you're losing of those mitochondria, the more they are linked to worse gait speed. That tells us that decline in mitochondrial energetics is one of the primary theories of aging. The decline here, as we see more loss of mitochondria, is what we are seeing in association with gait scores. And that cytokine, TNF-alpha receptor 1, was associated with significantly higher mortality risk. So people died more as the inflammation levels were higher. So that's the summary of Article 1. The higher the levels of circulating cell-free DNA fragments were associated with worsening gait speed longitudinally, so years down the road. Article 2 looked at the genomic DNA fragments and how it is linked to both dementia and cognitive and physical function. And while the mitochondrial DNA are linked to mitochondria, which is energy, genomic DNA is just direct proxy of how many cells dies in the body. So the higher the loss of cells in your body, that higher the level of genomic DNA fragments. So you can see how that's relevant in many of the diseases of aging, like sarcopenia, like frailty, because the more you lose of your muscles, you get higher genomic DNA fragments in the body. Again, we looked at 631 community-dwelling older adults. We looked at genomic DNA fragments, and we tried to examine if the levels of the genomic DNA fragments is linked to cognitive and physical function. And our findings show that higher levels of the circulating cell-free genomic DNA fragments were associated with lower global cognition, which means overall cognition, and slower gait speed. And just to give you a little bit more of specificity, so higher levels of genomic DNA fragments increased the odds of developing dementia by 27%, which is really a high percentage. Uh-huh. And longitudinally, higher genomic DNA fragments was also linked to steeper decline. So everybody, as we age, we walk slower. But the higher the levels at baseline were associated with steeper decline in both cognitive function and increased frailty over the 8 years of the study.
Did you see any differences in gender or race, ethnicity?
We did. And there were differences that we had to control for both the race and gender, because they varied from one group to the other.
Were the patients who participated in this given their results, or was this, let's draw blood and use this solely for study versus informing the patient of their results?
This is a research study, and it's a part of a comprehensive analysis that's done through the Rush Alzheimer's Disease Research Center. So this is just one of several hundreds of studies that are ongoing to look at dementia and physical function in older adults. We have not informed the patients because it's hard, again, to say that we found this and then this might happen to you in the future. It's not fair and it's not ethical. But I'll ask also, some of the participants were part of many other studies that will be very confusing to try to update them on everything.
So they're probably donating their tube of blood for quite a few studies, and that's good.
Correct.
I want to make a plug for clinical trials of this nature. Oftentimes people think that a clinical trial, a research study, is solely based on giving you a new medication, and it goes far, far, far beyond that. And this, I think, is a good example of how we can offer ourselves up to participate in a research study that has absolutely nothing to do with taking medications or having a procedure done to us. And yet the results of this can be quite phenomenal. I can picture this as being one, I'm going to call it, diagnostic tool, along with screening tools, mammogram, colonoscopy, et cetera, that when we put these two together, hopefully we'll be able to diagnose people sooner. Is there any possibility that someone might get what I call foxhole religion. And so they say, I want to do whatever I can to prevent cognitive dysfunction, prevent frailty, prevent dementia. What would you tell them to do?
This is an excellent question. You're cutting directly to what matters most to our older adults. They don't care whether this is genomic or mitochondria, whether it's floating in the serum or it's inside the mitochondria, but what does it mean to me? And I want to just highlight that our research is just opening new possibilities for early detection and intervention strategies for dementia and frailty, and potentially opening new possibilities. We're hoping that by identifying those elevated levels of cell-free mitochondrial DNA or genomic DNA, we can identify people that are at higher risk for these conditions at an earlier stage, before you start to see the fall. Because once a person falls, you already know that they have progressed enough, and sometimes it's too late to do something right about it. So yep, our hope is that we can build this in a way that allows us to identify people to say that, I think you might benefit from seeing physical therapy. Let's look at your nutrition. Let's look at your exercise. Because yes, everybody will benefit from exercise. Everybody will benefit from good, healthy eating. Everybody will benefit from less stress, right? Can we focus, since our resources are limited, can we focus on identifying few select individuals that, based on some objective measures, we know that may benefit from a more focused intervention? It might be also a way to keep monitoring the changes in those levels as years pass. Maybe some person will have higher levels in a one incident, but then changes in the next visit. This is our hope for the future. So we're not saying that this will be definitely something that will be used for dementia or frailty, but our hope is that to develop it enough in order for us to be able to identify our most vulnerable older adults before they become dependent on others or needing extra interventions.
You mentioned earlier about socialization, the importance of connecting with others, having time to visit with someone, to talk with someone, to see them. I recall during the pandemic, there were some photographs shown on the news that just broke my heart. There were three different patients, two women, one man. All three were in nursing homes, and all three weren't able to be visited by their family. And they showed them about a photograph of them about 6 months before the pandemic, and then about a year after we were able to stop saying we still are in the middle of a pandemic. And these people looked like they had aged 10 to 12 years. It was startling to see it. And I thought, boy, oh boy, the importance of human contact is incredible. It's absolutely incredible. I mean, we also know that if we don't hold a newborn baby, hold them and rock them and talk to them, that they can have a failure to thrive. Absolutely. Older people can also have that failure to continue to thrive.
So one of my mentees, who's an associate professor in Texas, University of Texas, has been working on developing technology for older adults using an Alexa-like app. So she provides the Alexa to older adults that are homebound and sets it for them. And that Alexa will give them structured exercise that they do on a daily basis and some exciting cognitive exercise that they can do. Interestingly, the preliminary findings of the study showed that those participants that had Alexa had lower frailty scores than the ones that did not. And it wasn't because of the exercise. And the speculation that the study principal investigators commented on was that their thought that having the Alexa in the apartment forced the older adults that are homebound to get up and talk to Alexa because of that intellectual stimulation. They wanted to talk to somebody. They wanted, even if it is a device, even knowing that this is not a real person, that made them more excited about getting out of their place to talk to Alexa and ask to listen to music and ask to listen to different news or something like that, that you started to see less frailty impact, so faster walking speed. And that really fascinated me, because it really talks volumes about the impact of social isolation, and that
yes,
clinicians are skeptical about AI and technologies, and that we need the real connections. But maybe if that real connection is not there, maybe the best next thing is to work with technology, to work with artificial intelligence to provide that level of communication. And maybe it's not perfect, but it is something rather than just cursing the darkness, lighting a candle.
Right. My husband is older than I am. My husband just turned 84 last week, and he doesn't have email. He doesn't know anything about a computer. He has a flip phone. When I got Alexa here in our house and showed him how he can ask her questions and such, he was fascinated by that. And he really treats her like she's a family member, to the point that about 2 years ago, he said to me, "What does she look like?" And I was like, so I gave him a description as to what I thought she looked like. I also had a friend who was in a nursing home. She was in her early 90s. We could see that she was just existing and not living. Her daughter got her a mechanical cat that purrs and turns its head and raises its tail and pushes back on her chest. And that brought her out of wherever her mind was, that she always has that cat. She's always striking that cat and talking to the cat. And when she talks, then the cat will do a louder purr back to her. And I thought, this is incredible, that we do need to find substitutions for the absence of other humans. I thought everybody should have a mechanical cat. Or maybe a small dog. I realize not all people are cat people. That wouldn't be fair. So looking at AI, where do you see things helping us regarding these kinds of issues? Everybody's talking about AI. It sounds like it's going to be the magic bullet for everything. It also might be dangerous, too, for people that want to use it in an inappropriate way. How might we go beyond Alexa?
So let me give a little bit of background. I am an associate professor of medicine. I'm an MD, and I have a second appointment in the Johns Hopkins Whiting School of Engineering. We work with engineers to develop technologies for older adults to increase their independence. I am one of the PIs of the Johns Hopkins Artificial Intelligence and Technology Collaboratory for Aging Research. So those are one of three national centers in the U.S., that were tasked by the NIH to develop new technologies for older adults using AI. We have built our Johns Hopkins Artificial Intelligence and Technology Collaboratory for Aging Research on the fact that there are tons of opportunities in the aging world to work on, from frailty, from dementia, from delirium, from incontinence, osteoporosis. And on the other side, there are tons of AI technologies. And our role is to connect the engineers to the clinician scientists and let them talk to each other and work on developing new technologies. We fund new technologies for older adults. And this year is our third year of providing funding for startups, academia, to develop new technologies. We have been working with engineers to develop new devices, robots, AI algorithms for older adults.
Fabulous.
And AI has been playing an increasingly important role in geriatrics for many reasons. That heterogeneity of aging will take an AI to be able to deal with it. There is no one show fits all. When you take care of one 70-year-old, that's one 70-year-old. Everybody's different, and you have to have a sophisticated system in order to do personalized management, diagnosis, and all the interventions. AI algorithms can analyze large data sets to identify patterns and predict outcomes, which can improve that early detection of disease like dementia and frailty. As you saw in our papers, we divided frailty alone and dementia alone. But to start putting everything in one pot and look at the overall picture, you need a very highly sophisticated system in order to analyze the tons of data that you get from one person, let alone the whole system. So for example, AI can go through medical records, imaging genetic information to identify individuals at risk and recommend personalized treatment plans for that person in that moment, in that visit. Additionally, AI-powered tools can assist in monitoring patients' health remotely, providing real-time feedback to healthcare providers and enabling timely interventions. So there are a lot of potential of AI. And just to give you a simple example of a technology that we have been funding that comes from a startup from Baylor University. It is a unit that you place at home based on a Wi-Fi technology. When you have a Wi-Fi router at home, you're walking through a sea of waves. And if you solve the algorithm, you can detect movement, you can detect falls, you can detect breathing rates, you can detect adverse events in older adults. So you can see how this can serve in a markerless way, in a way that you don't have to wear anything, but just having that in a non-intrusive, non-invasive way in the home of your loved one, and that can send a signal that your loved one just got up and fell without having to do the life alert or something along that line. So the future is for developing such technologies. I'll tell you that we have been looking at many technologies, and that crosstalk between business, clinician scientists, and engineers is critical to our mission, that we talk together so that when we develop the technology, it comes out vetted by key stakeholders, older patient advocacy groups, even business specialists, because we want to see those devices in the market, not in 20 years from now. We're talking about 2 to 3 years from now. And that's the new mission of the NIA in developing those technologies. The instructions that we were given when we founded the center is that we are not looking for something for 20 years from now. We're looking for now devices to be developed and commercialized in the next 2 to 3 years. And with engineering, a lot of that is possible. Maybe pharmaceutical, maybe genetic, it will take a little bit more time than that, but developing devices, developing AI algorithms, it doesn't take much time to develop and work together to validate it in an age-friendly way and make it useful for our older adults. When we met with Dean Schlesinger, the Dean of the Whiting School of Engineering, he gave us a couple of thoughts, and he said that I'm not looking for developing the next robot or something like that. I'm just looking for a device that will allow an older person to open a jar. I'm looking for those simple, practical devices that you can develop using technology to make staying at home possible and safe and improve quality of life for our older adults. That's our mission, basically, building an ecosystem where we all talk and develop new technologies for our older adults.
Do you share information with orthopedics or certainly with physical therapy, occupational therapy, because they're able to tell you all my patients with XYZ cannot get the lid off of a jar or cannot hold a fork as they used to, so that we can create these devices that would be specific for what the needs are? I don't think that the general public, if they don't have a family member that is older, I'm not sure that they are really aware of the gradual loss of independence situation. They might visit their grandmother and see that she's not as sharp as she used to be, but they have no idea if she's just eating cereal, because it's easy to shake the cereal out of the box, but it's not easy to get the green beans open.
So I'll tell you that we do a lot of handholding in order to develop the technology and move it to market in such an accelerated pace. We need to be involved at all the stages of the development of the technology, including recommending consultants, co-investigators that will be able to weigh in on exactly what you suggested, Lillie. What are the struggles of older person? What do I see in my clinic? How do I assess for post-operative success of one of the surgeries in older adults, like hip replacement or knee replacement. How can I detect? So some of the technologies that we're looking at now is looking at spinal surgeries. And because that's such a major surgery, you need a way to determine who should go for a surgery versus who should go for physical therapy. So AI can offer that. AI can look at alignment of the spine, can look at the movement of the person and provide a much more objective assessment of the older adults and say, based on the following criteria, the best possible option would be for continued physical therapy based on A, B, and C. And I want to just add a hope message. So I direct what we call the Gerotech Incubators Program. Gerotech Incubators Program, unlike the AITC, is for mass graduate engineering students that want to work in the field of aging to develop technologies for older adults. And when we established that Gerotech Incubators Program under the Human Aging Project, we were giving the mandate by Ed Schlesinger and Chris Dorso and others within the School of Medicine and the School of Engineering to do the following. Let the students do unpolluted, unrestrained hunt for problems and solutions. So don't tell them what is wrong. Let them discover it. Let them go to the clinics, the dementia clinics, the osteoporosis clinics, and let them find what is wrong with how we are doing things. And unrestrained, don't tell them how to solve it. Because quite frankly, if you knew how to solve it, you would have solved it already. Let them do their things and find new technologies for older adults. So we said, sure, we will do that. But one of the heartwarming things is I ask each cohort of students to tell me why they want to work in aging. And I prepare them in advance. This is what I'm going to be asking. The group of students that I remember clearly brought pictures of their grandmothers and grandparents and say, I am working in this field for this person, that I want them to be able to live independently and happily at home. And that definitely gave me hope that if we have a second and third generation that are noble and that wanting to do it for the right reasons, I think we have hope. I think actually those graduate engineering students are a beacon of hope for us that taking care of your older adults is not a burden. It's something that is the most noble thing to do for older adults.
I have always said that when passion and purpose come together, extraordinary things will always happen. These very smart and caring individuals are saying, I love this person and I want to see what I can do to continue to have him or her be active and enjoy their future as an older adult. That's pretty phenomenal today, really is. I wouldn't be surprised. I can picture them all having a photograph of that individual on their lab bench or on their office desk. I have put a photograph of one of my patients who has stage 4 metastatic breast cancer, and she sits on the desk of one of our lead laboratory researchers, all of his, whether it be a student or a co-researcher in his lab. Every single one looks at her picture every morning, and then she comes in to visit with them every 3 months and say, show me something that's going to excite me or will excite a future patient with stage 4 breast cancer. And they're even staying longer in the lab than they're required to because they've related to her so well that we know that we're doing this for Judy. And we want to keep seeing Judy, right? We want Judy to still be able to come in and not be gone. So very, very smart to ask the why. And for that to be the answer, again, tells you that these people are in the right field and that they're doing the right thing. Do you have any other take-home messages for our listeners today?
The key take-home message that early detection and intervention are crucial in managing age-related conditions such as dementia and frailty. And that the hope is that by monitoring biomarkers like the circulating cell-free DNA fragments, whether it's genomic or mitochondrial, we can identify at-risk individuals early and then maybe implement some of the strategies to mitigate the risk. I also want to add again that embracing advancement in AI can enhance our ability to provide personalized and proactive health care. And I don't want to end without saying this again, that it is important for older adults to maintain a healthy lifestyle, like regular physical activities, balanced diet, mental engagement, and as they can also contribute to reducing the risk of cognitive and physical decline. Thank you for having me, Lillie. Really enjoyed our talk, and thank you for providing this platform to discuss those important topics.
Well, it's been a joy to have this discussion with you, and it certainly does provide, in a very significant way, hope for the future, because all of us are getting older. The only way to stop that is to not be here anymore, which is not the good alternative. So thank you so much for joining me today. And I know our listeners have definitely gotten a lot out of listening to you today and filling us in on what's going on, including in the world of AI, because so many people are more worried about AI than they are enthused about AI. You give us a reason to be enthused. So we want to hear from our listeners. Are you enjoying our podcasts? Are there particular women's health topics that you would like to have a future podcast cover? Please email us at awomansjourney@jhmi.edu and let us know. In the meantime, I hope you will join us next month featuring another Johns Hopkins Medicine expert. To receive information about upcoming podcasts and other women's health content, please visit the A Woman's Journey website at hopkinsmedicine.org/A Woman's Journey to sign up for our monthly email, read about the upcoming podcasts and in-person programs, and also sign up for our upcoming free Conversations That Matter webcasts. Thank you for joining us today.
Thank you for listening to A Woman's Journey podcast. Join me, Kelly Gear Ripken, your host, Lillie Shockney, and a variety of Johns Hopkins experts on the first Thursday of each month to learn about medical advances in women's health.
A Woman's Journey acknowledges unrestricted educational support for our podcast, Healthy Insights That Matter, from Astellas.
For more information about A Woman's Journey's virtual programs occurring throughout the year and our monthly webcasts and podcasts, visit our website, hopkinsmedicine.org/A Woman's Journey. Like us on Facebook and Twitter, and visit our website at hopkinsmedicine.org/A Woman's Journey. Until next time, stay well.